wanna come up? You wanna have a seat right up here, and then, we'll get started soon if Caroline gets up here. Awesome.
And then on this page, the goal.
Awesome. Thank you. Wherever you're ready, George.
This is new to me, so.
No worries, we're just here to hear what you, do you have a copy of the, you have a copy of the CIP schedule that, as it sort of stands now, but good luck seeing it. We're all, in the same boat, so.
Yeah.
But, I'll let you go, why don't you go ahead and do what you had to present, George, and then we can, we have questions, so. Well, this group's not shy about asking them, so.
I was told that they would probably have to replace the boiler and probably take that off your list.
Okay, completely off?
Leave it down the road.
So leave it on.
They found a problem with the air intake.
Okay.
The boiler's been handling the building fine since 2009, they think it'll handle the building for a while.
Sounds good to me.
So wasn't drawing the correct amount of air?
They have an air intake, because you direct that system.
Right.
I guess part of it was plugged, the guy said they took part of it out and put, and said to him, put that part back in, he said, the system's running fine.
All right, then.
Yeah, I mean, we have to, you know, we'll run it a couple, another year or so, and it's.
So let's leave it on the,
I wouldn't take it out of CIP.
On the schedule, then.
Move it out to 2020.
Yeah, I definitely take that out. Where it was, it was.
Yeah, it's 2018, so that's not.
No.
I would say at least 10 years, so let's put it out of 2020, so.
You think it's the last 10 years?
It's only 8 years old now.
What you mean?
I do have a price for roadside mower.
Okay.
$12,000.
$12,000, just barely made the, it cut off, which is good.
Yeah, was that in roadside mowing attachment, is that?
Roadside mowing attachment to a 5-hour broadcast.
Okay, so instead of 25, that line goes down to 12?
We were looking at a different one, I had the guy from Broadcast come in, and they came up with a roadside mower for 12, well, it's $10,000 plus a weight kit, so $12,000 will cover the cost.
And it'll fit the one we have for.
And then that's installing the attachment. There's been a lot of talk about tobacco.
Yeah.
We're gonna leave that alone.
Okay.
We'll get the, parts to fix it, everything's working on it, except for the diesel tank gauge.
Okay.
I talked to Mike Spiny, who's run it quite a bit.
Yeah.
He said the machine's not as bad as it's.
It made out to be.
There's been some issues with it.
Okay.
We believe everything, we've been running it the last few days, moving trees and stuff.
There's no issues with the transmission? Or haven't been any?
Not to my knowledge.
Okay.
And Mike didn't say nothing about the transmission.
We should still add it, though, like put it way out somewhere.
Yeah, it probably should be in your list somewhere.
It's not on the list. Yes.
So, are we talking about replacing it, or?
They talked about trading it, I guess, that was, like I said, it was before me, I looked at the operating of it, I run it myself. You're gonna take too big a hit if you get rid of it now.
What is the estimated life expectancy of that piece of equipment?
Oh, you should be able to run that thing for about $10,000, it's gotta come out.
Is that, what year wise, is that,
That varies on, I mean, usage, of course. You're not gonna use it as much in this town as you would in a construction site, you know, I mean.
Would you estimate we can get 10, 20 years out of that machine?
If you can get all the 10 out of it, easy.
So, is that something then that we should throw on there for 10 year out, and then if it's fine, we can just keep pushing it out?
I think that's good, so we keep trying it.
Right, and then the other thing is it's worth more to trade it then.
Yeah.
You know, in 10 years, instead of waiting till it's not worth anything.
Exactly, yeah. So, shall we put it on, for?
You have a note here, yeah. We put it on for at least.
Yeah.
10 years.
And what's, ballpark, do we need
Yeah, I was going to say 10% or so.
Buying a machine that's capable for our needs, I know this one's had a lot of problems, and I would hate to buy something that's...
The backhoe, if we're going to do work ourselves, roadside ditching, grading, if we decide to help the water department with some of the ditch work, that machine is sufficient. It's not a bad machine. I've talked to a lot of contractors. Volvo made a good machine. That was the last year they started making wheel machines. So they did away with them. Town of Berwick bought a cat the same time they bought this, which, you know, you're spending around the same kind of money. However, you know, we had no issues, and it's no different in size. Ideal size for the town.
All right, so we'll put it on a schedule at least.
Top-kick GMC, 6,500.
Yeah.
I was talking with Sam, the mechanic at Dover Highway. Mm-hmm. He said sooner rather than later, the truck probably should be thinking about it. The truck was overbuilt for what it does.
Yeah.
However, you got it in 2 years from now, maybe next year. I think we can get to another winter. I talked to the guy drilling this year. He says it's underpowered. Yeah, the truck itself is not in that bad shape. It's not beat up.
So we're talking about the top kick. We have scheduled for 2018, so next year anyway.
I guess they were going to move it this year because of the issue they had with it last year.
Well, this year's budget is next year.
We're talking about 18.
No, no. They moved it to 19. I mean, originally it was going to be in 2020. It a year up because of problems they had with us.
Right. So you're suggesting we go 2019 at least?
Yeah, we can go, you move it out another year.
2019 is...
And the other thing I would like to see is a utility pickup truck.
Okay.
Whether that needs to be on the Warren article or, instead of the capital improvement plan.
Well, everything goes on the capital improvement plan. Up to or over a $10,000 threshold. Right? So the idea is to be able to plan your X amount of years, in this case 10 years worth of savings that would be required. But everything would still require a warrant article anyways to get the money out to actually to buy what you need. So just so on.
What happened to it?
We did not buy it.
But it got approved by it.
It got approved. Yeah.
But why didn't we buy it?
There are opinions now that it's not the size is not sufficient, that we should have been planning on what George is asking for now. George is not the first person to suggest this, that it should be a larger vehicle that's capable of holding a plow. When we were first approached to do this, it was a utility vehicle that people were going to run parts for. It's now morphed into something else.
So didn't Jeff try to make it to be a plow vehicle at town meeting and it didn't pass?
We talked about this and kicked it back and forth.
Right.
And it was
we didn't want him to plow it. We wanted him just to have something to pick up parts and go.
And then we were all sort of surprised at town meeting when that came up.
Right, but it didn't pass. But it did pass for what we had to do.
So the select board has decided at the moment not to... to buy, but that doesn't mean we can't by the end of the year. But we're now listening to, we have not spent the money. No. It would stay in the capital improvement.
I was going to say,
So that's why we haven't bought anything yet. If we don't buy it, then it could go for something else in the CBM.
Would the recommendation be to buy, and I know we went between 3/4 ton, 1 ton, a 1 ton truck?
Okay.
Or
my recommendations is a utility body pickup. So we can have our equipment in hose cabinets on the truck and have it when we need it. The thought of having a plow on it is not to be a main plow truck. It's to be a backup. You have the truck capable of plowing if needed. It's not going to be used all the time for plowing. It's going to be, if a truck breaks down, we do have a backup. The truck is there to use. You know, if we can chase parts with that truck, we're not running around a 10 and a half dump truck.
see that if we do buy this as a one-ton vehicle, and best laid plans aside, I think it would be used for plowing, probably more so than our initial intentions would be, because it's there, it's convenient, and it's a brand new, fully functioning vehicle, which now turns into a vehicle that's maybe suffering a shorter lifespan because the workload upon it is greater than what the general intention would be. But the flip side of that is if we do buy a one-ton vehicle to run parts, now we're driving this big, heavy chassis around, when we put it in a truck for significantly less, just to run about half ton, that you can still put a utility body on, and still be, thousands of dollars ahead of the game, but you've lost the plowing ability. So it's, I'm sort of on the fence about which direction this would take.
Right. The only problem with putting the utility body on a half-ton truck, the body itself weighs more than the regular pickup truck body, so you're adding extra weight to that size vehicle.
I understand.
So that's why I went with the three-quarter to a one-ton truck, whatever. And I don't recommend a diesel with a small vehicle, because there's been a lot of problems with the smaller diesels they've had recently. A lot of mechanics are saying stay away from the diesel with the smaller trucks. So that's one reason why I just get regular gas engine. I told them, bottom of the line, just give me some prices.
Well, I agree with you on getting a heavier vehicle that can serve our purposes. And also, we're taking a little bit of the load off some of our main, more expensive, equipment as well, sort of sharing the load in those peak times of need.
And we definitely need that extra vehicle. I mean, we can't ride three people who go to a job in the front of that dump truck. And I don't really want to take a bigger dump truck out just for the ride, to go out to a job. Like the other day, we're going out chipping. Well, there's three of us. We required two vehicles. I took my own vehicle. I'm not worried about that. But I had to come back for a meeting anyways. But there's a lot of reasons that you're going to need,
You shouldn't be expected to. Right. You don't expect that.
And I'm not. But I had to come back for a meeting. I didn't want to run around with another truck. We weren't that far away, but there is a need for a second vehicle. I mean, running to Concord to get parts when you need parts, running that dump truck is crazy.
Mm-hmm.
It's absolutely crazy.
I
understand where you're coming from on getting a lighter pickup.
Yeah,
but that truck's going to be used for more than just that. It's going to be used more for working around the town. That's why I suggested the utility body.
Okay. And so that would be for 2019?
That was hoping for this year.
Okay. All right.
I'm just bringing it out there.
Sure. Yep. We're just taking notes right now.
How much is the CFP for the pickup we didn't buy?
20.
So you're talking.
We could go with a pickup truck and just get a couple of tool cabinets put on the side, not have all the big tools with us. I'm just, this was just a suggestion. Previous time I worked in, we just replaced a pickup body with a utility body, and having the tools with you makes a big difference. And they're out of the weather.
Okay.
I don't have anything else.
So the Bobcat is scheduled for 2021.
Yep.
Seems reasonable to you still?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. Now, especially where this roadside mower fits on it, I was going to suggest otherwise, but the guy says that machine is capable of putting a roadside mower on it. Might as well get the use out of the machine we have.
I don't disagree.
And this mower will satisfy all the needs that we have.
Yep.
Going from a 25 to a 12, it just seems like I'm buying an inferior or lesser model.
No, no.
It's a
different style. This is a different style mower.
25 was supposed to go on the side of the backhoe, right?
It was a different style mower that goes on. It was a boom mower. This is a boom mower also, but it's a rotating boom mower instead of one with the, there's two different styles.
Okay.
And the guy said this is a sufficient mower for what most towns are using.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we have, most of the time we're cutting grass, we're not cutting brush. The other one's more like a bush hog,
Right.
Start cutting trees and stuff. I don't think there's,
Right.
When you get into that kind of tree service, I don't believe. I mean, most of it's grass filled up on the side of the roads, and this roadside mower, he said a lot of towns have the small one.
Alrighty.
I'm just looking to see, get something to take back off quicker.
Or your chainsaws or anything that gets into the
Right, if you need trees.
didn't get to do it this year because the person that we were contracting with the machines,
he blew the motor into shape.
And the guy before that didn't want to do it anymore. So
there was talk about the state wasn't going to do it. And then this year they did do it. And I saw that they did a bunch of Portland Ave and they did some Main Street here. So they did do some things. But they keep talking about not doing things and discontinuing things. So it feels kind of tenuous.
Almost like you should anticipate that.
They just
rented that machine to do this year. They rented a piece of equipment in the state.
I'm sure it's coming.
But what's the liability? I've always been working on the state road.
Well, that's a really interesting question. If they're going to refuse to do it, we have to do it. But then exactly that, I don't know.
Why do we have to do it?
Well, because it's a safety hazard that it has to happen on the site.
It definitely was.
If they're not going to do it, then...
But, I mean, isn't that their issue?
There are a lot of things that they told the road agent in the spring that they, when they redid Rollins Road, like this was, they painted at the corner of Oak Street and Rollins Road, there's a turn lane, and they painted the turn lane, and they said, this is the last time we're painting this. But it's a state road. So I don't know what you do with that.
You were at the final arbitration point. The state says we're not doing it, and the county says they're not doing it.
Right.
And then the town goes, well, I guess we're stuck with this. So.
Is that the same thing we can do with the road?
Eventually, absolutely.
Let's not invite that.
It's the state one.
Anyways. It has been for generations. Okay, so anything else, George?
I think we can leave what was on there.
You're comfortable with the dollar amounts that we have in so far? I understand that you don't have a crystal ball, so I get it.
The truck prices are going to be not the 160. You're looking at bringing that up to around $200,000.
So we switch that to 190.
Right. No, you'll be safe.
Okay.
You know, depending how long it's out, of course. But.
We'll keep talking about everything every year.
Yes.
You know,
this is not set in stone. Things change. They come off.
And
they come
I understand
on,
that, but I know they just purchased. $200,000, but it was a 10-wheeler, so you're in the 190
ballpark. Okay. There's no doubt about it. I appreciate all what you've been doing, but especially around the heating system, that's really good to know. And the back door.
There is some things I'm going to do to protect the heating system over there, because all the pipes are coming out of the floor with no protection. They're only plastic, so I'm going to put a shield around that so we don't take a pipe off.
We appreciate that, too.
Do you know what we pay to have that service down on that boiler that corrected the problem?
No.
I'm not sure we got the bill for that, because that wasn't
that.
That
was kind of coming up, I guess.
Yeah, so no, not yet. Hmm. And it may be covered under contract, too. It may not be, like, so no, I don't know.
Just parts. We're to cover it's
service it's contract. Typically parts and reduce, it's a discount on parts and a reduced labor fee.
So.
Well, people that did this time and found the solution this time. Someone different that looked at this time than in the past, or has it never been looked at?
That's a good question, because it's always the same person. I don't know about the same person, but it's the same company.
Yeah, they changed hands.
Who is it?
So it's Townsend, but Townsend changed hands like a couple of years ago, but it's always been from borderline through Townsend. So.
Mm-hmm. But it's just amazing to me that we're looking at replacing a system, and a guy comes in and boom. This is all you need. I mean, how do we miss that? You know? How did they miss that?
Are they the ones that said you need a new system?
Yes.
They
said that the system was underbuilt for that building, that it was not the appropriate model item for a big industrial space like that, is what they said.
Mike says it's like a sauna in there in the wintertime, so
the value of a second opinion, I guess.
Well, I'm glad you got it, George. Thank
you. No, he says it's running fine. He told Wayne that, you know, when they took the air intake out, can you do it for everything's running good? I don't think you need to do it this year. You know, if it breaks down
even
a couple times, then you might want to look at it closer. But right now, it's running. I mean, you wouldn't replace the boiler in your house.
Okay. I mean, even if you get out a year or two, is a bonus for us.
Right.
You want to look at immediate expenditure.
Yes, sir. Yes.
That's what I was looking at. You know,
great.
See what the guy said it's running good right now.
Yep.
See if it goes to another winter. If we don't have any issues, you try it again.
Awesome. Sounds good. Any other questions for George? Thank you very much.
All right.
Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
It's time to call back the fire chief, please. Oh, George, you know what? question. I need to come back. I got a question. A couple questions for you. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I've got. We started the meeting late because questions were printed out for me, and one of them has to do with. It has to do with you too much. So don't go far.
Oh.
Yeah. The paving. Suzanne talked to you about trying to get.
I have a quote coming.
Okay.
The fire station.
Yeah, for the side lot there and
then
the front?
Face the front, correct.
Okay, never mind. We're good then. You're still waiting on the quote then, okay.
Yeah, I'm just waiting. I thought it'd be here today, but he wouldn't.
Okay.
Could you just give that to me when he comes in?
I think he's probably going to mail it to you. Well, probably in a box.
Awesome. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, all right. Members of the committee had some questions that came up after you left, you and Kevin left last time. And some questions came up at the select board meeting as to how we came about the quotes for paving. That's why Suzanne wanted to have the new road agent look and see if he could get, if we think it's too low.
Probably
we're
is.
We're not looking to spend more money. We want to be realistic if we're planning, right? So.
Yeah. The number that we put in there, the 15, you're saying is too low. And that is a number that I got from the previous road agent. That's what
okay.
That's what's
okay.
Right.
Okay.
I don't, you know.
You're not the paver, I get it. Exactly.
Yeah,
I'm not even
so,
I don't
have
rely on our
ability to guess at that stuff, so I came in with that number.
So that number, I think, is probably just for a binder. So the question is the goal a binder, or is the goal, like, you know, how serious of a paving job do we want to do, I think, is what that number
okay.
is. And that was just for the side lot,
yes.
Not
correct.
The front.
Correct, just the
yeah.
side.
So it's probably just putting down a little gravel
yeah.
and putting it
well,
on there and not making it any
foundation,
right.
Yeah. Which is
yeah.
just buying time.
Right.
But how sufficient is that? You know, that's what was at the transfer station for...
Based on usage and where
you know,
put
so
parts on it.
And the question also is the where it falls down on the priorities. Where does it go?
This is the new revised.
It's saying needs to move.
Right. Can you read that? Without glasses? Good for you. So there was some concern with folks here and at the select board that is that truly the number one priority when you've got into the air filling station, portable radios, and the forestry unit, do those things trump the parking lot? And those are just what
trump
I remember from, that's what I remember from the conversation. The other people actually,
does the parking lot trump those things?
I guess that's, yeah, sure, exactly. I think I said it backwards, you're right.
At this point, the reason why we put the parking lot first was because it's a priority. The other things, the forestry issue came up once we started having, again, mechanical things with the last little bit, so we kind of put that there. We didn't want to start adding more vehicles to what we're trying to do, trying to get service what we've already committed
sure.
to. So rather than run down and keep throwing new stuff in there, we said, well, let's slide that parking lot up, because that needs to get done for many reasons, just not because for our people in and out of there, that could use an awful lot for events at the station, and it's very hard to maintain, especially when it comes time to plow it and take care of it, because we push half the gravel away and we're starting again, so it's a constant, you know how many times I've been in here asking every year to have the roadie come in and do some work in there.
Right.
So that kind of slid that up to the top. The air filling station is something that has to happen, but right now we have some work we need to take care of within the fire station to accommodate that.
Okay, that's good.
So the electrical upgrades, which
sure,
we're starting to go
yeah.
through now, we can't do that until they are complete. So we're going to do
that
some of
sense.
Those first
okay.
in order to get the air filling station. And the forestry, as I said the last time when we were dealing with it, that kind of slid up and they told us to be getting it again, the same problem we've had in the past, to get to the point where we need to start looking at it. So that's why we slid that, is the two spot.
Okay.
I'm still grappling with the hilltop people to deliver the tile. You know, I've been told 2 months ago that it's going to come, and I'm kind of very well convinced that, yeah, that they gave it to Rochester, and then we're circling around trying to get us another one, and it was supposed to have been in 2 weeks ago, and they're telling me it's still going to be another week next question, so.
I know, Mark, at one time they were also talking about having an exhaust system put in, you know, to put on the trucks when they start. I'm not sure that, we wanted to make sure you understand, we're looking at a plan that's gonna go 10 to 15 years out. So if that's still part of what you're hoping to see one day in there, we probably should be thinking about putting it in it. Doesn't mean that we have to put money in immediately, it just means get it in the books, put it in the paper.
Put it on the wish list, I think.
Exactly, and start thinking really long, long range.
And not so much a wish list, I mean, this is something you need.
But it is something you need, well.
Yeah, it's something you need rather than, you know, a wish list, I think, geez, wouldn't it be great to have, but this is something you really need. I mean, if you're working in there, you can't be running trucks in there with all the exhaust.
Thing with that, you know, the exhaust systems that you're talking about, the plymo vent system is what was the one that they've had in the past. New technology has changed an awful lot of that. New equipment changes an awful lot of the needs with that. And now instead of hooking hoses up to the exhaust system on the fire truck and having a vac system that dumps it outside, which is what that system was, those don't even hardly exist anymore. What they do now is they hang these big giant cleaning vacuums in the station. And as a truck fires off, these automatically come on and they clean the air with a filter system. But because of the new and efficient way that they're building fire trucks now, they don't create nearly as much diesel as they used to. So just technology has caught up. So that's kind of a new system now. Is that something the station needs? I think it's been discussed before, but I understand the need for this stuff, and I'd have to look at what cost would be for this kind of air vac system. I know some other departments in the area have done that, and if that's something that, I agree, it's something that probably should be on a list like this.
Local clarity, is any thing.
Just starting in line.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But, is that something you would like on the schedule?
Sure. I mean, I can understand the need for it. It's just not something that I focus my attention on at this point. Because there's so many other things that I have as a priority. As a
the other thing, by doing that, the community sees these are needs. If it's not written down, everybody's like, oh, well, we don't need that. And then all of a sudden, we need it. When you've needed it for 10 years, but you just said, well, we're not going to put it on there because we have these other issues. So I'd like to see all that stuff on there, and so everybody in town can see these are the issues we have, and they can ask you, hey, why is this on there? And you can say, here's why, and here's where it is. So I think that's the advantage or value of making sure everything is on there.
Yeah,
so.
Oh, I totally understand. I agree with that. Because I think even when it wasn't Harry after that for a while, when he was in there.
Yeah, but that's when you had the really old trucks, too.
The really old trucks. And, I mean, well, the big thing is, in the fire service, carcinogens from diesel exhaust is a huge issue when it comes to firefighters.
Right.
Used to be that heart attacks are killing them, now it's cancer.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's a race between either or, and that's one way to help prevent some of that stuff. So a lot of it is just, you know, taking care of equipment. If that's one way to, we're doing some work in the station as far as doing some painting and some seals. You come in and see what it looks like compared to, you know, some that haven't been treated and what we've been doing. It's like,
yeah. The other thing that we were talking about, and I know there's been mention here and there about stuff, and it's like renovations. Is there any renovations within your fire station, like your bathrooms, your kitchen, your this, that? I mean, those things should be on there too, because obviously they're going to be over a $10,000 price tag if you start looking at those kind of things. Again, low.
Okay.
You know, but get it on there.
Yep.
You know.
Yeah, if you wanted to renovate whole things, we've been taking care of the issues as they've arised.
Right.
I know we've had I've had quotes to replace things as they needed to be done, but as far as renovating a whole thing, we're doing some work in the kitchen now, and we're fitting that in under the station maintenance line.
Okay.
That's why that got increased a year or two ago. We're able to use some of the skills from some of the members of the department to do some of that work for us.
That's
good. Rather than have to renovate the whole thing. I mean, we've been making changes and upgrades. So other than, you know, putting something like that in there.
Right. And we hear that at the weekly meeting, so but we appreciate all that you've been doing to manage, especially that line. It's not easy to know that. But there's gotta be projects that are larger than the maintenance that you're able to do with your members. There's gotta be something else in that station. Like we've got the roof on, right? We've got the septic on, right?
Yeah, septic up 3.
Are there, I mean, that's not out, that's out 2024, 2023, and it might be pushed out more.
Sure.
If we don't really need it then, but at least we're planning for it now. Is there anything else that building needs structurally that really should be on the CIP?
As far as structurally goes?
Well, I...
Are you using that term? Other than, you know, different between structurally and renovating something is, you know, a little different one might
right.
do. Yeah.
Yeah.
Structurally, building is sound.
Okay. That's good
okay.
to know.
I don't have any problems with, you know, leaking roofs and
right.
not other than, you know, just what you would normally see here. You know,
okay.
you know, ice and filled up or something. Okay. We've been very lucky there. But as far as, you know, renovating something, sure, there could always be something that needs to be upgraded. I can look more at that. Building is very sufficient for what we need. We've upgraded the heating system
yeah.
a few years ago.
Right.
We had issues with baseboard heating. That got repaired last year by the proper technicians, found out what was wrong. We got that, so it's up and running. And yes, there's some little cosmetic
okay.
things I would say, but I think we can get those without having to put $20,000 down to renovate.
And we appreciate that. I think all of us appreciate that.
The building is aging.
Right.
That's, I mean, and I understand that.
You know, and I know that, you know, the space needs committee, you know, do we just build a fire police station? Do we make a joint thing? And I know all that stuff has been kicked around for quite a bit. So it's like, well, kind of see where that plays out as to how it affects the other side of things.
That's not going to happen. You know that, right?
I know that.
Okay.
We manage with what we got.
Yeah.
So if folks wanted the chief to come back. Are there any other questions?
Portable radios. Have you talked to Skip recently, Christian Berry?
Try Skip?
Yeah, talk to Skip. There's apparently a move afoot to replace entire radio systems and everything goes to like a smartphone. Talk to him and it's quite involved.
Anything with
so,
radios.
Yeah, but talk with him about
yeah,
that.
He's done work for us in the past.
Yeah.
He still does stuff for Stratford County.
Yeah, he's
right?
a Stratford County guy.
Yeah.
Right, so talk to him about that. And the other thing I think we talked about was rather than a capital item, should the radios be an operational item where you're getting 5 a year and replacing them out of operation
in the regular budget.
Rather than replacing them all at once, you know, you do 5 at a time and then they wear out and you get 5 more or whatever. But
you have the whole package and you have to continually do that every X number of years rather than keeping up with this technology. Yeah.
But
also,
if
you find out where the break is, where you get a better deal if it's 6
right.
or 5, you know,
exactly.
that's what we would go with, you know, but on your yearly budget.
But before you buy, you know, Motorola, Kenwood, whatever, talk to Skip because this thing's percolating out there. As part of the statewide thing and the change in bandwidth when TV stations moved and opened up that spectrum and so forth, so there's all sorts of stuff going on. So,
yep. Okay.
Check with him on that.
I will follow up with that because I know we still have all this information. So, do that. Skip radios. Okay. Was there any questions about the air filling station? I thought that was one.
There was a question.
You had
a question about the air filling station, I think. I put you on the spot.
Okay, that was more on the ramp up front when we were talking about the radio.
I think we were concerned. We didn't know where. There was rumors that we weren't
there's
getting
Summersworth
filled.
Has one.
This
yeah.
Summersworth wasn't doing it. And so where are you going to get your air now?
Summersworth still does it.
They still
their
do
system
it.
Is very old and antiquated. Mm-hmm. They have a grant, which is supposed to upgrade the air van.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to make it an air van slash rehab vehicle.
Mm-hmm.
And also with that money, they're supposed to try to upgrade their Cascade system.
Okay.
We're still utilizing the Cascade system because
mm-hmm.
that's part of why we're paying $1,000 a year mutual aid
mm-hmm.
Funds is to be able to have that system available for us. And also annually, we have to have our members do a fit test, which is they put their mask on. They have to go through a series
mm-hmm.
of testing to make sure that they're operational to go inside buildings and whatnot. So that's part of the reason why we do that. Do I have an alternative plan? I do. The place where I used to be employed has allowed us to fill their bottles there. They have a brand new, like, that's difficult, because you make the call and you call them, it's like, they're not there. They're busy. So it's hard to be able to, and same thing with Summersworth, that's why we run into that from time to time. So, again, that's why that sits right there, number three, something we've looked at.
But I'm telling you, the electrical upgrades, it doesn't make sense.
We really can't do much with it right now.
That makes more sense, I don't know if we.
But I think our discussions were, shouldn't that be a higher priority item? It's like our last meeting, maybe that was it, and if we can't do it until the electric upgrade.
Like that with the forestry.
What is it, what has to be the electrical?
That over the forestry.
Basically, or whatever.
What's the electrical issue that you have to get done before the air system?
The phase three.
Phase three.
Three-phase?
Yeah.
Okay.
And is, are you doing that out of the operational budget now?
Yep, that's what's coming up, that's some of what's gonna do here. You're starting that process.
So part of it's gonna be done this year, and then part of it's gonna be done next year, okay.
You have three-phase power to the building, though, I mean, outside though, right?
Yeah.
That's a huge savings.
Yeah, it is out there, just a matter of getting it where we need it. Yeah, so we've been working with him to try to solve that.
Who's him again?
You need to say him.
Simo.
Oh.
You know his name, I know him, Simo, you seem to know the whole name.
I do.
You do, yes, you do.
Your local electrician.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's down there, he's on our Willie Street extension over there, so he's been and done a lot of stuff for us. We like to utilize his services.
So it's that expensive, I have to do a two-year contract?
That's what the school did.
We did it in three phases, but the school, the first phase was to bring it to the building, we had to bring it over a mile. And we had to pay for it, Eversource was not at all interested in helping us do that.
Surprise, surprise.
Yeah.
But you've got it right out on the pole, on the front of the station.
Yeah.
Yeah. Still has to. Any other questions for the chief? I wanna keep him here if,
I was fine, if it's done.
All right, so.
Want to do it?
Along this vote, so it's, we're still waiting to get some other numbers from George on the ramp up front.
Okay.
Apron, ramp.
All that's good.
All of that, and then the sidewalk, that's still something that we wanna move forward with, so. All right, if there's no other questions for the fire chief, then.
Okay, there you go.
Very good.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. So, school, I don't want to put you on the spot.
No, I really.
And so, and you haven't finalized your budget, have you, so it's.
No, but as Bill was saying, the idea of the CIP, which is why I've been trying to get there, is to get things in front of the public. We know about all the things, the IED facility study that was done back in 2013.
Yeah.
Has been public, but people don't look at it. And so for us to do something more in a CIP way would be a good idea. We have no idea how to essentially have money to fund these things necessarily, except by taxation. So anyway, I don't think I made enough copies, but I might have just about what I said.
How about that?
And so the big things that have been identified are from the IED study.
Okay.
With the exception of a few things. Well, actually, with the exception of, you look down at secure entry, reconfigure nurse and admin offices. Security was never considered part of the IED study, so that was not included. Security was simply not included in that. And they made that very clear when they gave their presentation. Everything else was on there. The timeline is from the IED study. The amounts are from the IED study, so they're already 5 years old. Some of these items, and I have it in a note here, where we need new quotes on things. Some things we have started doing piecemeal under when we can fit them in. Ceiling tiles throughout. The original cost was $135,000 to replace all the ceiling tiles. And I just took a quick, I put it down to $80,000 because we've been doing them piecemeal.
Right.
Plumbing, we've been doing piecemeal. So the original was $310,000. What's not getting done are like replacing all the pipes behind the fixtures in the plumbing. You know, so what you see is getting fixed, it's getting updated, but they have been addressed at least now, going through.
But do we need to replace all the pipes in the building?
Well, that, you know, and that's, in terms of plumbing and the tiles and things like that, I think it's not something that has to be done, like, all at once. So it can be done when they need to be done, if that's your question, Bill.
Well, I guess that is. I mean, when I look at something like this, plumbing throughout, that to me says we're gonna take all the plumbing out, and we're gonna replace it,
yeah,
and the whole thing. And so my question is that necessary, or if it's working, it's been working since what, 1936? I mean, do we need to?
No, that's why I think continuing in a piecemeal way with those is probably the right way to go.
Okay.
Fixing them as they need to be with the fixtures. Self-flushing,
yeah,
toilets,
sure.
Things that, sinks that work better for little kids, mm-hmm, so they don't have to be reaching up. And you've been in the school, you could probably
yeah,
address it just as easily. But I think those kinds of things, replacing the fixtures has been really important,
mm-hmm,
to become more efficient. But again, I think that's something that can continue to be piecemeal rather than done all at once, I'm
mm-hmm
thinking.
Okay, and that's your point of greatest wear or failure, so you're actually using the fixtures.
Yeah.
Seems like pipes are often fixed as they fail, and then of course the failure point is what's fixed, or if it needs to be a run back to a main trunk or whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
That's generally how piping is often addressed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, especially when you're talking about excavating concrete flooring to get,
you
know, some of these pipes.
Yeah.
To
the wall.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
It makes sense, and you know a lot of that stuff now more intimately, obviously. So those types of things, I think. The big ticket items,
mm-hmm,
the annex roof is due, but we need to get new quotes on that.
Okay.
Is that the flat roof?
That's the flat. And the annex and the kindergarten roofs are the flat roof. And that is really tough because you don't want that to fail, obviously.
What's the lifespan of the current roof that we had?
Well, the lifespan on there, in the IEB study, it was due. It's like overdue. I mean, it was due. It's due now.
How old is the roof that's on there?
When it was built.
I believe it goes back to 66, and it has two layers on the annex part, I think, and one layer on the kindergarten part, or the other way around, I forget which. One has two layers. So in one case, a layer has to come off. The second layer has to come off in order to put two layers on
that. Is that roof?
Yeah, oh yeah.
So the annex,
yes,
roof, the annex roof is about 50 plus years old, and the kindergarten only about 20.
Different ages.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah, the annex was built in the 60s, the kindergarten was built in 99, it was added on in 99. So that's due, but again, new quotes and finding out exactly what I believe the one of the things that's driving it, getting it done, is that the section between the two is probably something that has to be done. But again, new quotes, and we'll have to see what happens. Maybe they'll say, oh, it's good for a few more years. That would be nice.
Well, with roofs, I mean, that's usually a pretty high priority of anything. That's,
yeah,
that's really protecting your investment.
Yes.
You can
yes
suffer structural damage fairly fast.
Yeah.
Right.
No. I just didn't know, what's the advantage of having a flat roof versus a pitched roof?
My guess is that the building costs were cheaper, is my guess. I have no idea.
Can you put a pitched roof on an existing flat roof?
You would have to put rafters and
yeah
pallet ties.
I mean, yeah.
They
can do it. I mean, it can be done, yes.
Cause, I mean, is that something that you would consider? Because, I mean, I know that it's always a concern when you have a lot of snow with your flat roof, that you got to get up there and you got to get all the snow off.
Well, interestingly enough, one of the reasons we want to get new quotes and explore some things is the possibility of putting solar up there. And that actually helps protect the roof if you have solar panels.
Flat,
no, they're not flat. They'd be up, but they would also protect the roof from wear and tear.
Right.
So again, that's something that's going to be part of looking at quotes for things, is putting some solar power up there. So that's just but it's a pretty immediate need, as you can see.
Right.
The date is 2019. The cupola, when the board talked about the cupola, we've talked about doing the difference between doing the historical fix or the non-historical fix. And whichever way we decide to go as a board, and we're leaning toward the non-historical fix because there's a big difference in price. And it does, it we still maintain our historical designation. That does not go away. But the board felt pretty strong, we're going to get new quotes on it also, but the board felt felt pretty strongly that that's something that it can help with community fundraising and see what we can do. That that's something that we probably don't want to go to the taxpayers for. So,
is it having a problem, or is
the
this
cupola? I mean, have
looks
you,
like
you,
it's
have you
yeah.
seen
it? I guess I haven't paid much attention to it.
It's
yeah.
it is the immediate eyesore when you see the school, and it's really unfortunate. I know people who come back occasionally who graduated from there like 30, 40 years ago come back, moved on from there, come back and go, oh, it looks so terrible. And it does. It looks terrible. So it could be removed, but that is not. There used to be antennas that go up through there, and it may be part of the existing ventilation system.
Okay, and so
but it does need to be.
Can you describe what historical versus non-historical looks like?
It will look. We won't be able to tell the difference from the ground.
Okay.
Historical means that we would use historical woods, historical workers and tools, historical paint. No, I'm serious. I mean, you know, we wouldn't be able to use. ASEC, which maybe we wouldn't use anyway, but we wouldn't be able to use it to have it.
Is there really a compelling reason why you would do it the historical way then if you're not seeing it in the ground?
No, and it, because even if we were to get matching grants, we'd still have to raise at least $50,000 to do that.
If it's historical, you could probably
you could
get
do it that way,
yes.
Right?
Yes, if we could get matching grants, we probably could. So we'd have to fundraise for the $50,000 anyway. And
but you're not going to do any better for the tax rate, though.
No.
As far as the status of the building itself, regardless of
The historical designation does not go away. So anyway, that's something that we're putting around. So main building windows actually fall under the same thing. They could be historical or non-historical. The figure that's in there is the non-historical figure from the IED study. That was
the original windows in there right now?
They were not replaced, they were simply clad, I believe. And they are a safety hazard for one thing. They're not very good windows, mm-hmm. and they're a safety hazard. It takes two adults to actually open the windows because if they fell back into the room, one adult couldn't hold them up. Mm-hmm. So
there's risk of that.
You can probably
are not really what you would call operable either. So
right.
You really got to put a
Kevin knows more
into
about
it.
Right.
But then you also got to weigh the heat efficiency of the room.
Right.
You know, because that's an ongoing cost.
You can feel the breeze come through some of those.
Yeah.
But it still goes back to the long term. What's this building's plans 10, 20? Where are we going? And
then
you can't.
Well, I'm
talking about the whole main building for the 100,000.
That's
the
whole main
building.
That's the entire main building. First and second floor. Oh, correct.
So,
anyway, so I won't go through. And then the others are very big ticket items beyond that. The secure entry, the ventilation throughout, the heating throughout, and go ahead.
I'm sorry. So when you say the secure entry, admin, nurse, I thought, is this a new phase or a new different part of secure? Like, I thought all the locks had, you know, swipe entry or some kind
of
security.
No, that's fitting. No, this is more a Homeland Security secure entry.
So, oh, like configuring it in such
yes.
a way that...
Yes.
Okay, I get it. Okay.
With the vestibule that you can lock off from the rest of the building so that if someone comes into the office and suddenly you realize they have a gun, that they can be locked out of the rest, or whatever.
Well, as it is now, if someone makes it to the front door, the secretary, the nurse, the principal,
right.
they're open.
There's no sight line. There's a camera. There's no sight line.
If you go to Somersworth School, you walk into a glass booth, and then someone comes in and looks at you, and then they go down a second door.
And that's going to go out for a request for information, a request for proposal. The idea is to move it around the back where the teacher's room is now. You're coming through the back door. And it also would allow us to close off the front, that entrance. It's not necessary. We have the entrance and entrances on the exits on both ends, so it could become just a facade front.
Oh, so when you say reconfiguration, you're saying
really
moving
move it.
Those two
move
people
it to the back, better access.
Okay.
Better access.
Well, you're not moving those people. You're just moving the where the visitors arrive.
No, you have
you're
to move the
people
as well.
People.
Everybody goes back.
Those people control entry.
Right.
Okay.
You've got to
come in.
They have to be there. But anyway,
any pressure from states or codes that have changed that require these sort of things in
schools?
We have not, but we have a lot of, what are they called, waivers. We have a lot of waivers at that school. Our classroom sizes are small, but so far, you know, the waivers, you know, they continue to honor the waivers.
If we're going to meet Homeland Security requirements, so to say, do they have a grant as well?
Yeah, and that would be something that we would explore. We explored Homeland Security grants, and we got the grant for cameras in the, outside the school. And it was a relatively easy match for us to do. So that was good. So the idea is to get this information out. These are the big items. We continue to do a lot. We continue to do as much as we can within our operating budget. The swipe cards and things that Caroline was talking about, we actually need all new locks and an all new locking system. It simply doesn't. The automatic locking, many of us who've ever tried to get in for a meeting on a Saturday or do something, it simply doesn't work. Mm-hmm. It hasn't worked for a few years now.
We are all going to manage that through your operating budget?
Yes, we're hoping to. If we're looking at it to be able to include it in the 2019 fiscal year 2019 budget, which is the budget we're working on now, mm-hmm. which we'll see shortly, as well as the Bell system doesn't work. The telephones and the Bell system is not reliable and doesn't work, and that means that sometimes the office has no communication with certain classrooms, and that is a complete safety issue that must be addressed. And so we will be looking to address that too.
At the time that this isn't working, do you have walking talkies or anything?
I don't know what they do, and I don't know if it's constant or if it's just sometimes they don't know if they work or they don't work. So it that's a safety issue.
Well, it's one of those things.
I mean, you know, they use cell phone while you know the teachers, I think, carry cell phones, but no one, teachers and students, are not. There's a cell phone. You know, I believe there's a cell phone policy where they're not supposed to have them out and about. So they have them in case of emergency, mm-hmm.
But that's a system that always must be ready to go.
Must be. Totally agree.
There's just no gray area.
Totally agree.
All right. Well, we don't have any control of you here. Any control of your CIP project, but we appreciate you sharing that. But obviously, there were two separate buckets of money, but they all come from the same source.
Well, they all come from the same place. And one of the things I'd like to sort of.
So we have large competing projects.
Ask this group to think about a little bit is, you know, if love to get your input on it, is, you know, if there is, you know, if it's feasible to even consider doing, and again, what's the future of the building? And unless any of us have a crystal ball, we don't know. I would love to see it be an operating school, and in my mind, I see it being an operating school, maybe not a K-6, but I see it being an operating school into perpetuity. It could easily, and I don't know when that cutoff would be, if it's 10 years from now, that it's just a K-3. I don't know. But I think sometime in the future, that may be what it is. But I think it remains a school.
Can you put this in this format so that it's all one, even if we just have a second page and it says proposed school capital projects, so it's all in one place?
I think we should.
We've had it in the past, we've had it on there, just so we can see.
I mean, I think
as
a working
yeah.
document,
it's
almost
yes.
the same money comes out of the town, and we can just differentiate it by saying these are the school issues and these are the town issues.
Right.
But there, it's all there, and the people can see it. That's the
I
important
think that's
thing.
The,
so the public can see
the
it.
Only,
so
the only
okay.
concern
you said
that I have.
So well, Bill, that's really important.
Yeah. And I agree with what you're saying. The only concern I have is I want to make people understand that just because it's on our working document doesn't mean we control what goes on or what doesn't go on mm-hmm. the CIP.
Right.
But they have their own,
yeah.
they have your own process. We don't, this is
well,
strictly
well,
just for the town side. I
well,
mean, if I'm with getting information out, I think
right.
that's
well, getting information out is helpful, but you see, we don't have a process. We have no way of putting money into a fund.
We need to develop one.
Well, we're not allowed to have a reserve fund, in essence. Mm-hmm. We do have a building, we
yeah.
have the building.
Building.
We have the building fund, and now we've learned that we can use it like a CIP fund.
Yeah, I don't know how SB2 affects this, and that's one of my concerns. But you could just, on your warrant articles, create a CIP fund.
No.
Why not?
It's the same thing
as your building fund.
Well, it has to be, yeah. Well, the DOE, and the DOE gets involved in that, of what we can have.
Is that because you're SB2?
No, it's simply because we're an educational district. We're
school district, we're not allowed to have, we're not allowed to have a fund balance.
That's not fund balance.
No, I know. So could we create another fund? We have the special education fund, and we have a building fund.
Right.
So we already have it.
Another fund when you have a building fund.
It can be used for.
It can be.
CIP.
And it can be.
Then you can put into that, just like you do.
Well, but what's the difference, though? Because really, either way, you're saving for building expenses.
No, no, she's saying, yes, that's okay then.
No, I'm saying, yes, it is.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, and they've been doing it when there's funds available, putting a percentage or a dollar amount into that.
Dollar amount.
But you also could do a warrant article. You also could do a warrant.
Well, it is.
If you choose to.
That's true. So that's true. It could, and that's something that we'll have to.
So it's kind of out of our scope, but you, I mean, you could use the same chart, I mean, that we, I mean, it was developed, not by myself, so.
Like, should we have a joint CIP? Should we have somebody from the school board that, I mean, because this is all, it's all the town money.
That's why I'm trying to get here, yes.
Right, but as a, you know, a permanent member of this.
I think we have to look at the statute again. I don't think it,
Well, I see what you're meaning. The school cannot put money in there.
Right, I get that.
So the school, you can't raise money saying it's for the school. Is what it comes down to.
You can't have one fund that crosses jurisdictions.
So I see what you're saying. What I would like is to have there be, have this CIP committee be.
One spreadsheet, but even within the spreadsheet, you have to be clear that you're not taking money from purposes.
Right, that's what I'm.
Money going in.
I think it's admirable to get the information out. I just want to make sure that there's no confusion as to.
Yeah, they have to fund their own.
Right.
Yeah. And just like the town taking money out, the school would have to take, again, has to go back, has to be a warrant article to take money out, just like, which we have not had to do.
But Julie serves here as a resident, not necessarily as representative of the school.
Well, no, I think the CIP, I think the CIP committee can be both.
Yeah, that's my point.
I don't think the CIP fund can be the both, but the committee can be both.
Right.
I would like that.
And then we put everything on, you know, one sheet or two sheets, and we have, you know, town, and we have school, and we can discuss this, and everybody can, you know, because it's all part of the big picture.
So I think there's the formal, what the statute says we can do.
Right.
But to do this, even though it may not say it's explicitly allowed in the statute that it's handled in this way, there are some things that it does say, like a planning board rep, but I don't think it says explicitly that you can or cannot include school. It's just about, I think, as far as the official written document is concerned, maybe it might, because it's part of the official CIP, have to follow whatever that statute is. But that doesn't mean that we can't have like a separate page that's sort of an addendum, as long as we clarify that it's separate. Like, I don't think that there's, that's a conflict.
Because honestly, if we're looking at projects for the town, we have to be thinking about the school as well. And the school
why we invite you to be on
has
CIP.
To be thinking about what, because it's all the same money it's going to come out of. So we each have to know what we're all thinking. So I think it's incredibly valuable to have, you know, school representative here as part of this group. So
why she's here.
It may be possible with, you know, our Excel master to work a spreadsheet that includes all the figures so that we can sort of, for conversational purposes, plan what you're doing what year and what we're doing another year.
Right.
It doesn't mean it necessarily has to be the official document. It's sort of a process document, whereas the town official CIP would be more like this, and it has our funds going into these project designated.
In the first year we reinstated this process, I think. Weren't you part of the working document? Right, but I mean, that was part of one big document, we say underneath school.
I think it was, and then money was just separated.
Right, but at least it was on the schedule so people could see it. And I'm fine with doing that, it's just.
Yeah.
I didn't come prepared to with the statute part of it, so I don't know exactly what's going on.
You viewed as an internal, as a worksheet document. Right. The same set of eyes, we're seeing the same set of money as a whole, plotted out over the years, so we can see what's coming due, you know, right? What's getting hit this year, what we can push out as a whole. Right?
And not only that, but not for us, but everybody in town can see that. This is, it's the whole, the big picture, so that everybody sees it.
So it's the school's responsibility to put their money aside, and it's our account to put their money aside.
Mm-hmm. So that makes sense.
It does make sense.
Well, it's helpful. Thank you all. It's helpful.
earmark certain values for certain specific projects?
No, we've been putting money there thinking it could only be used for emergencies. We got clarification last year that we can use it like a building fund. We can put money in, and we can then start just the way, well, you have things earmarked on a spreadsheet. You don't have separate funds for a fire truck. You don't have separate funds for a police cruiser. They're all in the same, they're all somewhere. It's all in one fund. And so we would just start designating. At the moment, we have $103,000 in there. I mean, it's not a lot of money compared to what we have to address in the next four or five years.
It needs something for the absolute emergency that does come up that's critical, must be dealt with. Same thing with the CIP if there's an issue as such. So.
Right.
So in that vein, are we ready to act on any of the department budget to make a recommendation to the chair in particular, and then to see the recommendation from this committee. So I think the one that is clearest to me, well, two that are clearest to me, general government administration and the highway department. The general government admin. We used to have the Colbert Fund on there. Suzanne is suggesting taking that out from the CIP, straight CIP. That's a separate warrant article, so which seems to make the most sense. But the boiler and the roof, you see that the boiler in this building would be scheduled for 2018, the town hall roof, 2023. We just got an estimate. Old Mill Lane Bridge, you'll notice, for 2025, we're on the, we've made application to the state to be part of the state bridge program where the money is available, which is not for some time. We would be responsible for 20% of the cost to replace that bridge. Currently, it's almost $200,000, you can see, it would be 20%. The state would pay the rest, 80%. Select Board has not, is going back and forth. The chair had some concerns with that. I wanted to come up with some alternatives, but until we have those, I would think that we just keep it as is. Town admin police facility, mostly police facility. We're waiting for quotes to come back this month, the next couple of weeks, for requests for proposals that we put out to see what realistically what would need to happen. We would have to bond, would be saved for a number of years, but we don't have any additional information. And of course, the renovated town hall is just in case someone wants to give us a pile of money, which no one has come forward yet, so, but it's not funded. So, are there any objections to that section as laid out, or alterations, or additions, or anything?
So Old Mill Lane Bridge,
yep,
is slated to start in 2021, start putting money aside in 2021, and runs on to whenever.
Yep.
And so why? I mean, do we know that the bridge is going to need replacement by then, or is that just a matter of...
The bridge that was put up, attempted replacement, is still listed as a red listed bridge with the state. So we need to come up with a longer term solution. Is that another temporary fix? Is it getting, as I said, we've made an application. We don't have to move forward with the, where it's a lengthy process to get on the state bridge list. So the money won't be available for some time. But you know, $193,000, a lot of money. It currently services two or three houses, I think. But that really is a move. Especially if you live on the other side of that, you want to do that.
No, I was just curious because I don't know what makes it temporary, but I don't think it's held up with toothpicks, and I think it's
no. And it's been damaged.
It has had damage.
We can't use the normal truck for plowing that we use for that road. We have to now go to a smaller vehicle because the plow can't fit through. There's a number of issues with that.
Six,
I mean, and we don't have a final decision.
And there's no way
on the other side of the bridge. There's no way of putting a road to go to right there.
There is a way, but I'm assuming it would
heck
of a lot more expensive than 190 than the 20% match for a bridge, but I think that's just a guess.
Yeah, all right, the only thing though, I was just curious because I kind of think of the Oak Street Bridge that's got the wooden bed on. I think that is like a temporary bridge.
No, that's very permanent.
But well, that's still
the city of Dover wanted a wooden deck, so the city of Dover paid for the wooden deck, but it's a state bridge. Yeah.
It is also still red listed.
It is red listed.
Oh, okay, so that was
it. Yes. Yes.
Thank you.
There's some big chunks taken out that I drive over every day and go, maybe I should go the other way. But. Yeah, so are folks okay with this section?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this is pretty much the easiest. I don't know, of course, I want to answer any questions that we may have, so we're going to pass that one on. And so the highway department, we can do police, I think, actually. So police vehicle equipment replacement. Bob wanted to, bump it up to 25. It was currently 20, wasn't it?
For,
it
was 20. He wanted to bump it up to 25, but he also talked about making 1 year a double year.
Right. So that we could have,
because we skipped a year.
Mileage, discrepant, higher mileage on one or two of the vehicles. One of the vehicles was totaled a number of years ago, and they weren't allowed to replace it by the previous board. So he's got two cruisers currently that have, what is it, 100 and...
One's about 150, and the other's got like, maybe like 125 or something.
High mileage for a police vehicle. It's a third of what I have on my car, but I don't use my car as a police vehicle, so understandable.
It looks like it's
so
25.
He wants to
move
across the board
it.
To 25. So I don't know how folks are feeling about that. Going with he wants is it was it lease for
that was one
for
thing.
Just those.
That was his idea. Is if you were to do a double in 1 year, was to lease them
just
and
those
for 3 years and then
right.
Yeah,
because we had been leasing for a number of years. We found out it wasn't as cost effective as the plan that we're living under now.
Mm-hmm.
What Bob says, so I don't I'm not going to argue with him. It's just it was just for it's a temporary fix, sort of a bridge to bridge program to get the mileage down. So they're all things are equal.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess it's more of a question of money allocation.
Right.
You know, are we going to bump up one of those years to 50? Or two of those years to 50. And what does that do to the rest?
Why are you bumping up to 50?
Yeah, it just says under Bob's notes, it's 25,000 and each year thereafter allows for the replacement of aging equipment within the vehicle.
So is that the point of raising it to 25 from
yeah.
20 is because there's going to be a double year?
No.
Because
no.
that
no,
will
no,
cover
no.
a double year.
It's before that.
The double year is not going to be 50,000. It's good because you're leasing it.
Right, but you're leasing two rather than one.
So
there's that, but then also, what is the, why are we going from 20 to 25? Or was it 22 to 25?
20.
You know, like why?
22 down.
Because that's quite a jump. Unless before the cost didn't include equipment. Outfitting, maybe? You know, but I think it did.
I think it
so
did.
I
no, it
know.
Did. So it was 22.5 is the, what we were. So he's suggesting bumping it up 2,500.
He might have gotten the current price adjustment.
Okay, so 22. So if we're just going to get up to market rate, so that's why we're going up to $25,000, how are we going to reflect buying two in a year in this payment schedule?
Mm-hmm. Well, when you lease it, it's not as expensive, right?
And that's only for 2 years. It's only for one cycle. It's not for it's not every year. You're not suggesting to switch to
So you're going to buy one the regular year? Because I thought he said lease two.
He's leasing two for buying it, right?
Yeah.
In a year, not necessarily overall, I don't know, in a year, yeah.
But if you're gonna have 25 for each year, I don't know if it's gonna be 12.5 for a year for each one, I don't know.
We can hold on this and get more clarity from the chief. That's fine.
Yeah.
The other two are much easier to understand. But why don't we ask Bob for more clarity. So that's fine. Fire department, we're still waiting for information to come, so I would want to hold off on that. The highway department seems pretty clear cut to me now. It makes me much happier. The roadside mowing attachment, it's 12,000. I think that's very reasonable. I can tell you we currently budget 4,500 for 1 year. So within 3 years, you're going to be in much better shape. Now, of course, there's also going to be maintenance of the equipment. I get that. But
when you're saying we're going to hold off because we're waiting for a price to come in, aren't we just authorizing what we projects that we're
going to
do?
Yeah, but I want to be able to send over a more complete package. We have realistic numbers to give to them.
Okay.
Unless folks let's finish the highway and we can go back and talk about it. I mean, the question is whether or not we think what the fire chief is suggesting for priorities should be priorities. I mean, it's.
I think it would. I think your board chair would appreciate a recommendation from this committee for budget.
For tonight, okay. Well, we'll see. Let's finish up the highway department first.
Yeah.
All right. So, are folks good with the roadside mowing attachment?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The GMC top kick for 2019, keeping that on the schedule for 2019. I think that's great. George can make that truck last that long, and that'd be wonderful. And you can make it last a year even after that, it'd be even better. But utility truck with plow for 2018.
The problem with being a plow, to be honest with you, but that's my opinion.
So for 2 years in a row, the one time we got in an accident and we were down on the plow truck.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't have an extra plow truck. So I get what you're saying. Like, you know, there are two ways to think about this. So it came from the people, the idea that there should be a lightweight something for most of the running around,
right,
particularly when there's miles.
Mm-hmm.
So there's something to be said for that.
Mm-hmm.
But then I think it's prudent to think about what is the cost to the town if, you know, these things are under heavy-duty use in the winter. How are we crippling ourselves by having only exactly the amount of equipment we need with no backup capacity?
My problem is that once something becomes able to do something, it is used more than it should be used, which means it puts more wear and tear on this vehicle when the intention was to be a vehicle that would go and get things outside of the Rollinsford area. And I had no problem with him wanting a utility backing and to have his trucks on to go and do thing or whatever they have to do. I don't have a problem with that at all. Plowing puts a lot of wear and tear on a vehicle.
It does. I'm not advocating for that.
I know.
There's just something to be said for we have a vulnerability in having, and then you're relying on contractors. And it's, you know, 2 years in a row. So I'm not saying that, you know,
but we also,
if we replace it, maybe.
If we're plowing with the smaller vehicle, it means we're not plowing with the bigger vehicle. So we would
because
save some wear
service
and tear off the larger vehicle. And even if we got the one ton, if that's what we ended up doing, the cost of driving that to Concord to pick up parts, I would imagine, would be less than driving the big truck. So while we wouldn't save as much as having a half ton that we can't plow with,
mm-hmm,
we would at least save some money by not sending the big truck back and forth all the time. So there'd be some there, but we would add the redundancy of the smaller vehicle. You know, is it an issue, is it more an issue with the, you know, for the town to direct and say, look, this is not to be used, you know,
yeah,
all the time, and is that possible to do that?
Is it possible?
They're out at 2 in the morning, and I'm sure that selectmen aren't gonna be monitoring what vehicles they
exactly.
use.
So that's
I just you yeah. know, I just wanna make sure that the vehicle that we're asking for is portrayed correctly to the town as well. Because we had that change at town meeting last year, which shocked me that we did that. And they were strongly opposed to having the plow truck. So
the other thing we can do is have a pickup that is appropriate to be a one-ton grade or some other not super heavy grade plow truck, but not and when we order it, it would have plow capabilities, but just not buy the plow equipment and wait for that, and that would sort of disable its inappropriate use in that manner.
But then it runs counter to the argument that you're using it as an emergency backup.
Well, in an emergency, you're buying like a $5,000 plow outfit as opposed to, as opposed to a contractor. I don't know.
It's interesting. I remember some of the public discussion, and it was even in the non-public, even in the budget committee discussions and other things, it was, don't we want that to be at least four-wheel drive? Don't we want it to have an extended cab? People were already talking about, get something too small. No matter what you do, don't get something too small. It seemed to be what I was hearing from the public. And it seems to me that George is sort of suggesting something that's a nice compromise.
And I agree with what Carolyn said about having just what we need.
Yeah.
I think that leaves us no room for error, no room for margin, which has been proven that there's been times that accidents happen. And we're left short-handed, and now we're scrambling to get coverage as needed, which to contractors becomes expensive.
So this is a recommendation, right, to the select board. Nothing is written in stone. So are folks comfortable then recommending the...
And then I see what you mean about
40, where'd it go? 40,000.
42.
Could be another
20,000. Yeah. I think I am. I hate to get something that's not going to serve our needs. And, I understand our needs to go to Concord and pick up parts and so forth, but when it's snowing and one breaks down, we still need the bigger... So my two cents for what it's worth, I'd recommend the larger truck.
So we should also look into, the consensus seems to be for the vast majority of that. Well,
I'm okay. I'm okay either way. I just want to make sure
it's because the voters are going to decide anyway.
Right. And I'm okay. If it goes on it, I'm fine.
Absolutely.
I just want my opinion.
We should look at what our costs were to hire contractors. Over the last 2 years, the two winters.
About $1 million an hour.
Yeah, but how much we actually put out. So, I mean, that could be, if you're looking at, if folks are saying, then how is it really potentially going to save us money? I mean, there is some really good 2 years worth of real examples of when we were down trucks,
we spent X
amount to. Now, keep in mind, this is not going to be, not the same as the largest vehicle that we have, our dump truck.
You're only going to do the little side roads.
Right. This would offset the 550. So, but still, I mean, that was down as well. So we should look and see if there were costs associated and how we can justify that. So, anyways, that would be my suggestion. So folks want to keep that on at that level, and obviously nothing else changed with the exception of the new heating system, which makes me very happy. Bumping that out to 2027.
Well, we're going to have a place saver for a backhoe we discussed as well. Get it on the list.
Kick it out.
Push
it
out
to
place
saver.
2027
again.
Did you get it?
No, and that's...
No, because he said he couldn't.
I think we'd pay 103 for it.
The Volvo?
Yeah.
So if we said 110, 120, I mean, just to
get it on
there. Now the question is backhoe, is that the most appropriate, or we had a front loader for a number of years?
Well, I mean...
We can evaluate that when the time comes.
Exactly.
I think it's more important just to have some kind of replacement idea.
I'm with backhoe, large piece of equipment to do stuff.
I'm putting 115 just for, what's the farthest that we've made for 2027 on this document. transfer station. We have to ask you about transfer. George, you're still here, right? All right. So we have a compactor on here, a municipal solid waste compactor that was purchased around 2013, we believe. We have it to be replaced in 2033. Is that still
okay? But we should put our second compactor on the list.
Yeah, we have two now, so.
So maybe put that up for 2027 because it's new. I don't know if that
falls within. Well, the one that's from 2013 is for 2033, so we want to go out even further. So.
Sorry, right.
Yeah, so the new one would be off the chart.
And
so
that'll also reduce the use.
Right. So we can add a second one on here just so it's on the schedule.
So it would be 37 then, because it's 10 years out. Yeah.
So this is an addition to what we have. It's if one fails, that's going to replace one, the oldest one. Or is this an addition to?
We own two, so we have to have both on there so that we know that we're replacing each of them at some
so
point.
So it's not, yeah. Not having three. It's
no,
correct.
No, no,
just
no,
replacing
no,
existing.
No. Please, no. Okay, so transfer station set, highway department set, other town departments, nothing currently planned. Perfect. We'll keep that as it is. Fire department. Let's go back to the fire department. All right. So we have the air pack filling station. We have a little more clarity around that. That seems to make sense to me now more than the, and I don't recall him saying that last time he came in, so I don't think any of us asked. So anyways, that makes sense. The portable radios.
I think we talked last time about just taking that off. Mm.
Well, yeah, we're saying we're trying to do it as an operational
budget.
Yeah.
So I mean, I think that ought to come out.
I'd like to hear what he finds out with that conversation you're talking about smartphones.
Yeah.
That's just technology. That's where everything's going.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't want to buy radios.
Right. And the suggestion was if anybody's going to buy radios, buy three or four.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's going to be some potential, some big changes.
Right.
That
right.
You're not going to have the portable radio.
Yeah.
Already
so
some help
the problem, though, is they all came at the same time. Right? They were 9/11 grant from
right.
Homeland Security.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. But I think if he does a little bit of change every year, it's much better than trying to buy a big bulk again.
Yeah,
but
no,
go to the next level.
But are
exactly.
Four new ones compatible with that many old ones?
Yeah.
But I'm kind of concerned about the smartphone issue, and only because of the position that they're firemen. They're in water. They're in Greece, and they're in.
And what they tell me, this is all there's like a Bluetooth speaker thing that sits up on your,
yeah.
You know, because we ask some of these questions. Now this was a police meeting.
Yeah.
And, but we did, you know, because it's supposed to be police, fire, emergency
yeah.
services.
Sure.
So I think the fire service really needs to look into those issues and how it would apply to them. But it's
there are a good number of places in this town where you don't get cell phone coverage.
Mm-hmm.
So it's
so
basically,
yeah.
You know, doing away with kind of the radio systems as we know it and going, it's almost kind of like cellular based. So it's pretty interesting, you know, data transmission, the whole thing, everything, voice data.
I can understand police as a fire, that would be much better, but I just, firemen are in some really awful stuff.
Yeah.
I can't imagine what
you know.
Discuss, when you're talking life safety issues, I can't imagine what you'd be throwing around if it could be, you know, poo-pooed so easily.
I hesitate even.
Mark needs to
up.
Talk to them.
Exactly.
Yeah, and Mark
exactly.
needs to talk. And I think that we probably just need to leave.
But when I heard about this, and knowing that the town is looking at this replacement, I, you know, and the recommendation again is don't buy a whole bunch of portables as we know them.
Mm-hmm.
And instead of buying a Motorola for $3,600,
mm-hmm.
you know, maybe buy one that's not as expensive,
yep.
It still works, you
yep.
know, all the things, but it's not the Cadillac. Get by with the Chevy.
Yeah.
So,
especially if you're going to replace it with
so
something else.
Do we recommend then? Do we take it off the CIP and just work
well, I don't think
the
we
other?
Take it off the CIP. So, here's one thing. He's got it for 2020 as well.
Right.
It's not for this year or even the next budget year. He just wants it on the horizon, right, that he's going to need to.
Well, he's going to need some next year, I think he said.
does have a radio operating line.
He does, yeah.
Yeah.
And he was gonna buy some, I thought he said.
I think I would leave it on there just visibility, but also encourage him. I think he heard us tonight, you know, just try to do it in your operational budget and, you know, get somebody a year so it's not such a big impact.
Exactly.
You know, and if it's, you know, if it gets to be a real problem because they all tank, then it's still under your CIP.
I just wanna make sure.
Don't pay money away yet, you know.
I just wanna make sure he has what he needs for next year.
Right.
Doesn't have it on.
It's not listed for next year.
Doesn't have it on for next year, so.
But does, he hasn't submitted the department budget yet, right? What does he have on there?
No, I just have a CIP.
But knowing that we were kind of recommending him to do that route, he could actually revise it if we're going to budget, probably.
So, we'll keep it on the schedule. It's funny, it's actually portable mobile phones, I should say portable mobile.
Yeah, I get that.
That's funny. Paved parking lot. I don't really see this as a priority, to be honest with you, but it's certainly not gonna be $15,000, it's gonna be a lot more than that.
Well, I will say that the back of the school, which is about twice that side parking lot, we did for just under $30,000.
That was paved previously, so.
Yeah, but didn't they reclaim it?
Was it a full reclamation or was it just?
Is the main, is the structure underneath the compaction and the depth that they went down, that they're footing.
So that was already there, is what you're saying.
No, the other pavement would have lasted, it was just a little loose gravel. I don't think that the parking lot at the fire station.
It's not, it's all dirt.
It's just gravel. I mean, it's great and everything, but it's not, I guarantee it's not.
All right, you're right, that makes a big difference, yeah. Yep, I wasn't thinking of that.
I just think that they have more and more public events and things there, and it's a very uneven and it's very difficult to walk on in the winter months and stuff, but, you know.
It's an ongoing maintenance issue, and then the dirt, tracking the dirt, and especially if you have events.
I mean, yeah, if it came to radios, paving, you'd pick the radios.
There's no
question.
Certain thing it needs to stay on there, but I don't know if it's number one priority.
Yeah, and my concern is, you know, let's get a real price for what we're gonna see, and 15 may not be realistic, because let's not just throw, you know, asphalt down on top and then have it all bubble and do everything. So we're gonna do what we need to do it right and see what that's gonna cost us.
I think we should change that priority of it all, too, if it's gonna be a much bigger expenditure. And maybe I would need to point that these, you know, that great electrical in the filling station is, you know, much more doable sooner.
So what do folks wanna do with it?
You want to wait and get the real cons, right?
Yeah, I do, but I'm being urged by our colleague at the end of the table, reminding me that the chair of the Board of Selectmen would like
more definitive
answer from us so she can find a line.
Would like real numbers, though, too.
Yes. I agree with that. So, you know what we can do? We can pass along all the rest of it, and we can hold off on the fire department until we get additional information from George. I hate to call us all back just for that one piece, but I'm not really comfortable sending something off that's not complete. But and I'm also not comfortable keeping it on the priority level it is anyway. So.
Well, we really need to go through all of these projects, and we've got duplicate numbering, and we haven't really evaluated. You know, we're talking about 2018, but we're really not talking about what we think about the order within a department.
Right.
Is it our job to do that, though? Our job to rate the priority? They're the ones that have to deal with it.
I think it is, because we have to, because it's all about the money. I mean, you're, like, we're hearing them.
Yeah.
But we're hearing them, and we're hearing all the other department heads, and then I think it's for us because we have to manage and try to flatline as much as possible.
So what you're saying is you need to rate fire against police, against highway, and see those priorities. Is that what you're saying? Know what he says is a priority?
I think both, but I don't want the perception of pitting departments against each other for needs, but managing the dollar amount, because you need to manage how much money is put away so that you can manage the whole system. But that doesn't mean, I mean, if the money is there for whatever purchase, it may get flipped around with another department, or it may get flipped around with another year. It's not, you know, but to manage the whole thing. And that being said, it's only an advisory board.
It's an uncomfortable place to be.
You know,
we're being asked to micromanage the folks that have been hired to be the experts in their respective fields.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's not really our job to do that. It's the select board's job, on board. So it will pass on to someone else, and then we will have to make that tough decision.
But in the end, it's the voters.
Absolutely. They're the final arbiter.
Say, you know, the department heads came to us with this, and we're saying by this, the way I read this, we're going to recommend a warrant article. We're going to recommend the select board do a warrant article for 2018, next year, for $20,000 to replace the town hall boiler. Is that correct?
Yeah.
So, and the same thing,
the select board will say whether or not they think that's appropriate to pass
the
vote. Right. Yeah. And so I think that is, as you said, it's both. Because we have to do this. And then.
And clearly, I mean, there are competing interests always. And there's only so much money to go around. There's only so many, well, I mean, you could put every single item on here and send it to the voters, and they'll tell you yes or no. I'm assuming that they would probably say no to every single thing on this list, but that's why we had to prioritize them.
But our role as a committee is doing just that. We're going to put in front of the voters what has been represented to us by the people in the know in these departments, what they feel is priority one.
But we're going to put that to the board who may or may not agree with this recommendation.
Ultimately, in the board, which is the vote.
Yes.
Yeah.
But also, the department has need to be at that meeting that the select board or who is going to say this is what they're saying they need, and if they're not there fighting for what they believe is the most priority list,
they tend to show up.
But that might mean that they have to fight for their what they want to.
For their piece, sure.
Yeah.
And not a comfortable position to be in, but it's the position that you've all volunteered, and I thank you all for volunteering for it.
The way to hang up for us is the parking lot.
Yeah.
Because that's 2018. If we get that to 19, then we're, you know, we kick it out another year. But do we get the prices that we're all looking for, and just say, you know, let's get a true, accurate representation of what this is going to cost to do, and do it 19.
You can't do a warrant article unless you have
the budget. It's 16,000 and it comes in at, you know, 47.
And realistically, I mean, so we've got to pave and stabilize the front ramp of the station, right? Where you see where it's setting.
Mm-hmm.
If you're going to do that, why would you have someone come in with paving equipment and not do a side lot at the same time? In the same time, why would you have someone come in and do a little small lot and not do all the rest of it? Economies of scale, right?
So maybe we should.
Well, except that they would be in town anyway. They wouldn't be at that location, but it's kind of a given that we're going to do something.
But is that going to be at the station?
Well, right, but it depends, because it depends on, I think, if the side lot, if we were all in agreement that the side lot was going to happen in 2018 or 19, it doesn't mean that the ramp that just got its Band-Aid couldn't last 5 or 6 more years. So is the economy of scale of doing those at the same time, you know, more efficient than, you know, the next time we have, you know, every year we have pavers in town doing it, you know, just because then you're constantly, like, maintaining them more often.
Our expert that we will, sometimes we listen to and sometimes, now Georgia just found out we don't always listen to, has to tell us.
Just a thought. Split it in 2 years. Do your base coat, let it settle.
Yeah.
On that side parking lot. At least get a layer in there, then come back and do it the second year. You get some realistic numbers to do that, obviously.
Well, that's you're gonna what have the settle. 15 may represent. I mean, I don't know. What you said, he asked the former agent, maybe that's what they talked about, I don't know.
I guess my concern is not so much the base coat. I want what's under it
right.
to be able to support whatever we put on top of it, not just to say, okay, we're going to just throw a base coat
right.
on
it. I agree with that. Get your base prepped the right way.
Okay.
Put a base coat on.
Mm-hmm.
By the time you wait that next year, you're going to see if there's any settling.
Right.
That can be alleviated when you put that second layer.
Right, but again, we need prices.
Right, that's what I mean.
So
that's what he's got.
When I get the price, I can ask him to, split it the way you want it.
Honestly, I'm more comfortable waiting until 2019. I mean, I still want
to
get the numbers.
I think they can wait another year. Why don't we just move it up to 2019 and say go forward with that, and then with that price, and then it gets adjusted after we have.
Well, let's look at 2019 and see what the demands are on 19.
Right.
Maybe that's worse than step 18.
Mm-hmm. Mobile board,
air packs.
Stabilizer.
Air pack station.
But I mean, so the number for pave and stabilize the front ramp is laughable. I can do $20,000. Mark was saying just the prep work alone. I mean, it wasn't done. I know everyone is shocked, but it wasn't done.
That whole thing
was standard,
dug
in
my
opinion. So.
Clearly, it wasn't done. It's showing itself.
But I think that's another reason we need a true cost. We need to have somebody come in and say, look, here's what we want to do. Dig that out, put in a proper ramp, and so let's get prices for all of it, separate them.
Right. The sidewalks is not a priority for me, I'm sorry. I mean, I respect the chief very much. I depend on him to save my life someday if I need it, so and his members, but I'm not sold on that. I want them to have an air filling station more so, and the electrical upgrade quicker than the sidewalk page. So, but he disagrees. he's working on it. I mean, I get that. So, but you good with putting it off at least a year?
I am.
Kevin? Judy? Caroline?
I like the idea of costing it out and getting a base coat.
We're still
on there, but
we're still going to get that.
I think I like the idea of a base coat because I think it's not a lot of money.
Again, this is a not set in stone. So we can make a recommendation to the select board that we're going to do everything this year, and they will laugh at us and say, no, you're not.
So this is what
we're really going to do. So
well, I think
when that information comes in,
I think it's already great that we're, all right, so we're moving the top kick from 18 to 19,
yeah.
And that's got an expense of $73,000 for 18. You know, you can now split that over 2 years.
Yeah.
You know, we've got some, you know, I think we need to look at the forecasted next few years, like what we're...
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the boiler, pushing that out to 2027 certainly helps. I mean, that's only $20,000, only on it, but compared to $190,000 truck, that's much more reasonable or easy to attainable. But that's been pushed out, so that's a plus.
Note that in the spreadsheet, the police facility, the gross capital cost did get changed to $75,000, but in 2018,
mm-hmm. You would like to put $50,000 in.
Did he say that? Because I thought he wanted that. Maybe she's just working this, but it says total for the 10-year period is 50, and then 25 from the CIP.
So it says prior CIP plan listed 40,000 for town and admin police facility for 2018, and thereafter 50. But of course, as priorities change, you can put less or more money in. So I mean, that was the best information that the chief had was working with. So, and he made the recommendation that in 1998, when we were discussing doing the remodel of the town hall, the town started budgeting $50,000 yearly for the bond from the debt service on that bond. So, for the chief is suggesting we would do the same. I guess why I put the $50,000 in, although I don't know if that's a realistic number. So. But.
I guess it depends on. As far as I'm concerned, what else we're asking for. You know, it's not just about, I would really like to see a top coat go there, but if we're really going to go with a new highway vehicle, that alone is going to more than compensate.
does it cost to get a load of gravel in? And
a few $100.
And replanted, you know, regraded rather.
That we do
versus,
in the
versus
yeah.
I think it's still underbid, $15,000. I mean it's a question of long term what is sustainable for costs and what we can do, what we can use at our what solutions we have at our disposal for short term. To me, if we can get by with another year or two of loads of gravel and regrading until we can get it out further where it's a little more manageable to do it, I think that makes more sense to me. But again, I don't park there every day. I don't, I'm not plowing it. How many times I have to plow in the wintertime? I mean, so, and I get that too. But again, we're looking at a whole list of things on the schedule, what's more important? Is it more important that we have enough money to put the extra in for a police vehicle so that we can get the mileage situation taken care of? Is it more important to, I don't know, buy the roadside mowing attachment so we don't have to spend $4,500 every year to hire someone to do the mowing for us? There's more things in-house. I mean, is it more important to get a utility vehicle for the highway department so that we can have a backup vehicle? Is it more important to repave the side lot of the fire station? I mean, that's...
It's value. I mean, is it you know, beyond just convenience and appearance, because obviously keeping the dirt out, it is convenience and appearance, but then you look at life safety factors, and then you look at mandatory factors, like the police cruisers.
I agree.
You know, I mean, we have been getting by with a band-aid each year, when we hold the gravel, short money, but it's not making the problem going away, but the task before us is... Not looking at just 18 or not even looking at 19, but looking at 20, 22, 24, 27, you know, the long range plan. And unfortunately, we could get hit next year with some very big bills. So it's always scary to push things out further than trying to, you know, pick them away.
I agree with you, but in my mind, it's a safer bet to push out a side parking lot than a vehicle. Or than a vehicle that's already outlived its life expectancy for municipal or commercial use. You know what I mean? And that's what we have done traditionally the past 20 years out of plow trucks that, or more, that probably would not be in service in a lot of other communities because we've been trying to be frugal on that.
Commendable. Well, this lot is still functional. There's some voids out there, like we talked about the traditional utility vehicles. I mean, we don't have those right now. So,
that's where it comes down to. What's the priority?
I see the big need for that.
I think we push it out and we get some real prices and it gives us a much
better. Well, they understand they're going to go up. I get that.
But we need to, if we're being asked to make these decisions and calls, I want to know a better estimate of what it's going to cost.
So 2019 it is for the side parking, right? Radar message board was fine, digital fingerprinting system was fine. It's for 19 and 20, so. Any other questions or concerns? Can we send this off to the select board?
So, let's recap.
I'm going to read again. Silver lining.
Can we just recap what we're
sure.
requesting?
Yep.
20 for the boiler.
Yeah, that was the last best estimate we had. Yeah.
Okay, and then we're going to... 25 the cruiser and do a cruiser. No, it's not a purchase. It would be a purchase year.
Two leases this year.
So is he asking for that for 18? Two leases in 18?
I thought because his mileage is already too high now.
Yes, that was the whole point.
Yeah, he's trying to buy some time. I think that was for the next budget year.
And are we... You know, was there a consensus in that here?
Well, it makes sense.
Okay. I just want to...
We might want to just
talk to the chief to make sure that that is enough money for a lease, two
he
leases.
Will, the chief will have to come back to the select board again.
Yeah,
And have a conversation
yeah.
with us. I mean, and he will.
I think it was his intent to do it next budget season.
$20,000 for the boilers being moved from 219 to 218?
The year says 18, yeah, and then the under 19 is the expense. Yeah, so I don't know if that's just for, yeah, it is.
The target year was supposed to be 18, so or something didn't get moved over then, so maybe it is 19 then, if it was taken off, but the expense was taken off. It's highlighted, though, you'll see.
Right.
And it's hard to see on the photocopy.
But it is.
It is, so that is a good question for...
See, that's why I just put my phone on the
library.
Yeah,
we can, yeah. She may have told me, and I've just forgotten. But, so I will make sure to make a note of that and ask Suzanne when we meet with her to do the notes. So, okay.
So are we not doing anything with the fire department this year except moving some money to make sure they can do some radios in the operating budget?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then the highway is 12 for the mower and 43 for the utility truck.
Mm-hmm.
And we're moving the top kick to 19.
19, yeah. Recommend
and
we're adding
the backhoe. Yep. Okay.
Adding the backhoe to the schedule just so we don't lose sight.
In the second compactor under the transfer.
Yep.
Adding that line with a kick.
Okay.
And then the new heating system, you got the note for that at the transfer.
Yeah,
at
I got
the highway department, right?
Are we increasing the price for the utility vehicle?
43
is what he said, so.
It's at 42.
Plus all the equipment. That doesn't include the equipment.
It did, is what he said.
Yeah.
It did.
43.
It was, where's my note?
Because the warrant article for this year was 20.
Right, right.
So that, I mean, the difference in prices is for a higher grade truck plus the utility body.
Which was about $6,000, he said, and the
plus
five
the
for the flower and the...
So that's 43 is the whole thing.
Yeah, it goes
along. Okay, I thought he said the quote was 43 for the basic pay.
No, it was 43 fully equipped with a utility body and plow.
Yeah.
So is that what we're recommending, 43?
If that's what folks think is appropriate. Still thought we were getting a little runaround truck to run parts for it. So
the
I understand exactly the reason why folks may go with a larger vehicle. I get that.
I don't think there's a whole lot of fuel mileage savings if you take the plow off from a half ton to a three quarter or full ton. I don't know that we're
buying something even smaller, but that's okay.
Like an
well,
yeah.
Yeah,
exactly.
Actually,
I mean,
segue.
Well, town meetings can adjust.
No.
You know, town meeting talked about it this year. Town meeting can talk about it again.
Exactly. I think leave it up to the people.
Because
you
they
know,
will
I'm not gonna
for sure
that.
Have things to say about it.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to have to, it'll be discussed, I'm sure, at length.
Or two, yeah.
I assure you of that. So, yeah, if we want to recommend that. Again, these are just recommendations, so it's not... falling on our porch, but I mean, what we're talking about is we listen to the evidence as presented by the folks that the select board has hired as experts or the voters in the case of the police and fire chief, and coming up with weighing that evidence against other things, right, and making a recommendation. So if folks think that George made a compelling case to go that route, then we should do it, and we should recommend it to the select board. I'm not saying whether or not.
He's sensitive to the town's budget, of course, you know, as we all are. And my worry is just buying too small a vehicle and absolutely destroying it for using it beyond its true means. When you buy a half-ton truck, and before you know it, you're going to load it right to the hills because she's pointing up to
well,
the sky.
Did he say that
the utility body itself is going to be tough on the suspension?
So already a half-ton's not going to cut it. If we put a utility body on it, we need at least a three-quarter. And, you know, foolish do we, you know, if we're in for a penny?
Where's that sweet spot?
Exactly. Where, what's the balance?
But the difference between a half ton and a three quarter ton is substantial. Between a three quarter and one ton is not as substantial.
Exactly. You know, so, in my view, that makes the case.
You might as well go
with the bigger truck.
It's money well spent.
And again, I'm looking at the savings from not running the big truck for parts.
Right.
We have this truck, which, granted, it's bigger than a half ton, but it's smaller than the
Pennywise a dollar foolish and pigeon yourself into too small a vehicle that does a little more than just the roundabout.
And it gives us the backup capability and more of a truck. That's my thought.
Send it off.
There should be something for sure, because it's just about what's the dollar amount. But if the board is really going to hire a second full time person, you need something for them to drive.
Big enough to hold the bodies.
So
works
well. It's written so much healthier.
This will then go to the select board. The select board representative will then go to the budget committee. It will then go to a public hearing. It will then go to the voters. So it's not the end of the process by a long stretch. So
that is the end of our journey, though.
It's the end of this committee's journey. Thank you again for volunteering.
Long,
strange trip it has been. Yes. Thank you, Jerry. Thank you all very much, seriously. Thank you for your time and your dedication. Again, you've all done this for a number of years, and I really appreciate it. So it's helpful to have these conversations. So,
thank you.
Appreciate it. Now.